Let's pray. Father, we give you praise and we give you glory because we know we serve the God who cares for us. The God who loves us so very much. The God who desires, oh Lord, that Father, Lord, everything concerning us, oh God, gives you honor, gives you glory. We bless you for today, the life given us, and much more this time, Lord, to listen and learn from your word. We want to give this time to the prayer, Jesus, may this word, oh God, be a blessing to each one of us. May this word, oh God, remind us of everything expected of us. Much more, may this word, oh God, encourage us, even in this time of uncertainty. The time, oh God, in the name of Jesus, where fear is ready. We bless you, God, and we give you glory. We pray that Jesus, have your way. Have your way, Father. We bless you because we know through this word, you bless us today. In Christ's name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is from John chapter 20. John chapter 20. We are continuing to use the resurrection story to continue to just encourage ourselves. We continue to use the resurrection story to continue to remind ourselves that God is alive and is still in control. God is alive and is still in control. That's our reflection this morning. God is alive and he's still in control. He has no church. He's still the same. He remains the same. And this morning, as we continue to use the resurrection story, just want us to encourage ourselves and remind ourselves that our God is still alive and he's still in control. John chapter 20, verse 19. Through to 31, John chapter 20, verse 19, through to 31, verse 19 and 19 records. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I'm sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and say, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sin, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks on his hands, and I put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands, reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord, my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Then Jesus performed many signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in His name. May the good Lord bless the reading of His word. Amen. Like I mentioned that, you know, we continue using the resurrection story just to encourage ourselves and continue to remind ourselves that our God is alive and, you know, He's still in control. And as we are using, you know, the resurrection story, John gives us a perspective of what happened when Jesus resurrected. This is the picture I want you to have, what was happening. Remember when Jesus was arrested, the disciples ran away from Him. They were scared to be arrested as well. They ran away. They were afraid. Remember, this is a person they walked with for 3 years. This is a person they depended on for 3 years. Provision was coming from Him. This is a person they called Master. This is the person they call teacher, and they knew that He is able to protect them. He is able to provide for them. He is able to see them through in every situation. This is the person they followed and looked at Him doing miracles. When He is arrested, they are running away. But Peter, we know that he followed Jesus, and 3 times he denied Him. And when Jesus, I know, was crucified, died, and buried, these people were still afraid. They didn't know what would follow. They didn't know what would happen. And John is giving us a picture of what they were doing. The Bible saying they were locked. They locked themselves. They locked themselves in the room. And as they were locked in the room, I'm sure they were asking themselves, what next, brothers and sisters? What are we going to do? Our Master is gone. Our Master is not here. Remember, these are the disciples that they even forgot everything that He was telling them. And I'm sure even at this situation, while they were locked in that house, they forgot that Jesus told them that on Sunday, I'm coming back to life.
Amen.
So while being locked in there, wondering what would be next, wondering what would follow next, we know that Jesus already has resurrected. And when you look at verse 19, it says the first day of the week, they are talking about Sunday. And this is the day that Jesus has already resurrected. He is alive. He's got life. And as they were talking, they forgot. But on the third day, He's saying He's going to resurrect as Lucas. And in that day, by the way, when they were talking and discussing, and I'm sure they were wondering what will happen, the Bible is saying, while doors locked, and they were afraid that there are people outside who are going to arrest us. The Bible says, while they were inside, doors locked, Jesus appeared in their midst.
Hallelujah.
Doors locked. You expect a person, if you are in the house, your doors are locked. A person to come in, you expect them to knock if it is locked. You expect them to open you to open for them to come in. But this is how Jesus is trying to show us that, by the way, when He is resurrected, our God is not limited. Our God is not limited by anything. No physical thing can stop our God.
Amen.
While locked, doors locked, and they were wondering what would happen next. The Bible is saying He appeared to them. And if the doors were locked, And Jesus resurrected, we are just being, you know, given this picture that, you know, when he resurrected, his body was not limited. No matter could stop him. No physical thing could stop him. He's able to appear anywhere. He's able to be wherever he desires to be. And at this time, after resurrecting, he's appearing to the all and to every disciple. And as he's appearing, those locked up, and I'm sure when he appeared, some of them wanted to run away, but they forgot that their doors were locked. That's why his first words are, "Peace be with you."
Amen.
You need to understand, in this time, when I look at this picture, I'm looking at the picture that we are at. Doors locked, wanting to be scared to be outside, scared to go outside. This is a picture that I'm seeing even here. They were afraid to go outside and doors locked. But this is how God is reminding us. Yes, we can be home locked, doors locked. We cannot be here meeting like the way we meet every day. But you can understand, in your home, God is there. In your office, God is there. Wherever you are spending your time, as we are told, not to go outside anyhow, your God is there. Why? Because nothing can limit him. Not even time can never limit our God.
Amen.
He's above everything. No situation, no physical thing can limit our God. He's a God who can never be limited. And as he appears to them, these people there, they're wondering what is happening, and he says, peace be with you. We'll come back to that statement. And as he says that, the Bible says, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were overjoyed. They realized our God is with us. We need to understand. We don't need to see him physically. We don't need to see him like the disciples saw him as he appeared in their midst. We need to understand. For us, we know it is by faith, because he has promised he will never leave us, he will never forsake us. We know he is with us. Why? Because we know nothing can limit our God. Not even time, no matter if his creation can ever limit our God. Because he's above everything. He's above whatever happens. Because he's above whatever we see. Even that in which we don't see, our God is above that. That's why, child of God, you need to understand. You don't save a God who can be stopped. You don't save a God who is limited. You save a God who is above everything. You save a God who is with you everywhere you go. Yes, you can be now locked in your home. Yes, you can be afraid to go outside like the disciples were, fearing the Jewish leaders. But you can understand, your God has not left you. Your God is still with you. No wall can stop him. No door can stop him. No time can stop him. He is with you. All what you need to do is believe that even in this time of fear, even in this time of uncertainty, your God has not left you. He is still with you. It might seem as if our God has left us. We might be asking. Someone was questioning, asking me, was saying, "Babu sir, if God soon is there, why can't he just, like, you know, just put a stop to everything?" We know he can do that. But you gotta understand, he says he's a sovereign God. He does things as he desires. That's why all what we need to do as children of God is just to believe that this God is with us. This God can never be stopped by anything. Nothing can stop him. Why? Because you need to understand, he's a God that nature listened to him. He commands nature, and nature listened to him. Remember when the disciples were at the sea, and the storm came, and Jesus was sleeping, and they thought, "We are dying. We are no more." They thought, "We are done." And when they were thinking, "We are done, it is gone, we are gone," when they woke him up, Jesus stood up and rebuked the wind, and the sea was calm. I love what the disciples say afterwards when he did that, when the storm was calmed by him. I love what they say. They are questioning themselves. They are saying, who is this man? Who is this man? That's Matthew chapter 8, verse 27. He said, the men were amazed and asked, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey. Hallelujah. You see, sometimes they thought we had done when they saw that storm, when they saw the winds raging, that they were thinking, we are done, we are no more, we will never survive. But we serve a God who can never be limited by anything. Nothing can limit our God. He created everything, remember, and everything listens to him. So you need to understand, your God can never be limited by anything. All what you need to do is believe that this God is truly with you. Why? Because the disciples thought, we are safe in here. No one will come in. No one will disturb us. They were thinking, we are sealed in here. Nobody can appear in our midst. But here is Jesus. He's appearing in their midst. Why? Because he can never be stopped by anything. Our God is not limited. Nothing can limit him. Coronavirus or no coronavirus, our God is still God. He will never change. Jesus said yesterday, today, and forevermore. Nothing will limit our God. That's why, child of God, as you are going through this uncertainty, this trying time, what you need to do is hope in this God. Trust in this God. Know that nothing can limit our God. Amen. Hallelujah. The first statement that he made is saying, peace be with you. This is the statement he's making. Peace be with you. And by the way, when you look at the passage we have read, he said that statement three times. When he appeared, and my imagination is, I'm sure they were thinking, we are dead, we are gone. Who is this who has appeared in our midst? And he says, peace be with you. When he finished talking, and when they were overjoyed, they celebrating that Jesus is in their midst, he repeated the statement, he said, peace be with you. When the next Sunday, by the way, when he appeared, when Thomas was there, it was another, the following Sunday, while they were still together, still doors locked, again he appeared. You need to understand, for them they thought, oh, we are safe. When Thomas was told that Jesus was there, we know what happened. We know about Thomas, the doubting Thomas. But after a week when they were together, when he appeared, his statement again is, with you. You see, when I look at this passage and I look at the time that we are in, I'm imagining these are the words that Jesus is still saying to us. Because we have the time where we are thinking it's challenging. Peace is no longer with us. But he's saying, peace be with you. And I'm sure when you hear that statement, peace be with you, some of us, we don't have peace. We are wondering what is happening. Some of us, maybe we are even wondering, what are we going to eat? We are wondering what will happen tomorrow, especially when we start hearing more cases being announced. We are wondering what will come out of all these things. But you need to understand, when Jesus says, peace be with you, my question is what is he saying? When he says, peace be with you, you need to understand, he's the King of Peace. He's the one that gives us peace. But for us, by the way, to understand that peace is with you, and we serve a God who is unlimited, he can never be stopped by anything. This is what I want you to understand. For us to receive that peace and understand that this peace is with me, God is with me, is to understand who this God is. Because if you don't understand who this God is, still peace ain't going to be your portion. If you understand the God that you say, peace is going to be your portion. When I look at Psalm 46 reminds me that my God is ever present. My God is my refuge. He's the one who is always there with me. In other words,
an ever-present
God in trouble.
So in other words, where you feel like things are not okay, if you know who your God is, a God who can never be limited, a God who can never be stopped, a God who says when you run to him, you are safe, a God who says he is your refuge, ever-present help in trouble. When you understand this is a God that you serve, yes, things may not look good, things may not be impressed, but if you know you see the God who is ever present in every situation, peace is going to be your portion. Well, because your God can never be stopped. That's why Jesus three times is mentioning peace be with you. When you met them the first time, he said twice, peace be with you. When he appeared, when Thomas was there, he mentioned once, peace be with you. Why? Because he is the giver of peace. But for us, we need to understand. For us to have peace, we need to understand who this God is. Our God can never be limited. Our God can never be stopped. Yes, we are in our homes. Yes, we are not doing things as we do every day, but you can understand your God is in that house. Your God is wherever you are. Why? Because he is ever present with us. Even in this time of uncertainty, you need to understand he is with us. And if you understand it in that word, peace is going to be your portion. He's a God who is ever with us. He's a God who is faithful. He's a God who has promised he can never leave us nor forsake us. Not even this way, our limited God. Because it's very easy for you to start thinking in this situation, maybe my God is dead. This morning I've come to remind us our God is still alive. This morning I've come to remind us our God is still in control. That's why don't lose faith, don't lose hope. Trust this God. Hope in this God. Why? Because he can never be stopped by anything. My God is not limited. He's ever praise and help in trouble. He's a God who is able to put a stop to every war. He's a God who is able to stop anything. That's why you gotta understand. Even in this time, he's still God, a sovereign God. That's why for us, what we need to do is to trust and hope in this God. Amen. That's why when Jesus was speaking to Thomas, he's telling him, when Jesus appeared, he says, peace be with you. You see, the second time he's appearing to them, while Thomas is there, this is one thing I want you to note. Immediately he appears, he didn't address the whole group. He addressed specifically Thomas. And he showed him what he wanted, that's what God was showing him. Have you seen my hands? Have you seen my side? You see, it's very easy for us to doubt God in this situation because we are seeing that, you know, cases are going on. You know, this issue is like, it's not coming to an end. And we know that there are people that talked about it ending within March, others they say to end within April, but we see it still going and you start wondering what God did they listen to? And maybe you start wondering fear, you know, comes within you. But you need to understand. For us, the Bible reminds us, as the people who are justified by God, we live by faith. We are bigger. When I look at this story, I'm being reminded the God that we guys save, the God that we save, is not a God who is limited. And because he's alive, still enthroned, even in this situation, he's with us. Amen. So when he's addressing Thomas, he's telling him, now you believe. You see, when he was showed the hands and the side, Thomas would speak to say, my Lord, my God, is now believing, trusting God. But for us, we need to understand, Scripture tells me, when we look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18, the Bible tells us we need to give thanks in all circumstances because it's the will of God in Jesus for us, in everything. So meaning for us as God's children, because we know the kind of God we serve is not limited. He can never be stopped by anything. He is a faithful God. In everything for us, we still remain hopeful, knowing my God is a living God. Knowing my God is still in charge. He has no change. He's still faithful. My God has no change. He's still true to who he is. So when Thomas is doubting, God is coming and showing him. And when Thomas believed, Jesus says, by the way, you believe because you have seen me. And he says, blessed are they that believe without seeing. So for us, it's just knowing, because his word assures us he can never leave us, he can never forsake us. He's a faithful God, a God who can never be stopped by anything. Believe that he is with you. Even in the house, he is with you. Even in this time of uncertainty, he is with us. The situation the disciples were in, it was a fearful situation, scary situation, where they feel like even us will be arrested, will be killed like our master. Not knowing what will happen next, but here is Jesus appearing to them and assuring them, by the way, peace be with you. In other words, I'll be with you no matter what happens. Hope in me, trust in me, and you see that truly I am God who is above everything. Your God is living, your God is not dead. Hope in this God, trust in this God. That's why in this situation, all what we need to do is to believe that truly our God is with us. Our God is a faithful God. Our God who can never leave us nor forsake us. The song I look at the encouragement that Paul was giving the church at Philippians chapter 4, a very common passage I want to refer to. Philippians chapter 4, when you read from verse 4 to verse 7, Paul is encouraging the church. He's saying, rejoice in the Lord. And I'll say it again, rejoice. And he says, let your gentleness, be evident to all. The Lord is near. The Lord is near. So you see, when I look at that encouragement, I'm being reminded, my God, who is not limited, he is with me, no matter what happens. Because no situation, no time, nothing can limit our God. So I don't know what you were looking at. I don't know what you were thinking in this time. But what you need to understand, your God is still alive. Your God is still in control. It can never be limited. We know that our social life is not the way it's supposed to be. But understand this one thing. He is the Son. And he can never be limited by anything. He was able to appear. Those locked, he was able to appear. That's an encouraging picture there. That my God is able with me. So he's saying, let the gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. And he says, do not be anxious about everything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. So for us, what we need to do is know that everything is there. So every situation that we may be facing today, give it. I love verse 7. Verse 7 is saying, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guide your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The peace of God that transcends all understanding. In other words, you need to understand, whatever you are looking at, thinking, maybe your God has left you. Your God is not with you. Maybe God is not listening to us anymore. My encouragement is, God is still with you. Amen. He hasn't left you, still with you. And he's a God who can never be limited by nothing. He's above anything. Those locked, he was able to appear in their midst. You need to understand, yes, this situation and certainty is with us. We don't know what will happen tomorrow, but you got to understand, he is a God who is still with us. And all what we need to do is to give him. And as he said to the disciples, peace be with you, you need to understand, peace
is with us because Jesus is alive. My prayer is to anyone who has lost peace, hope, because of the situation, my prayer is may God by His grace grant you peace. May God by His grace be able to assure you that He is with you. And may the peace of God that transcends all human understanding. My reminder this morning, my God is still control. He's still in charge of everything. That's why all what you need to do is hope in this God, trust in this God, and this God will be able to see you through. Remember, the just shall live by faith. We live by faith. In other words, we take God by His word. We don't compromise. We take God by His word. And the word He has given us this morning is a reminder, nothing can stop Him. He's above anything. And all what you need to do is hope in this God, trust in this God, and this God will see you through. I'm done for today. God bless you. Amen. Our gracious and loving Father, Lord, in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we want to say thank you. Thank you, Father, because we saved you, and God, who is still alive. A God who is above anything. My God, who can never be limited. Because when you resurrected, this story is reminding us not even walls can stop you. Not even closed doors can stop you. In this situation we are in, Father, we are spending most of our time indoors. Thank you for this reminder that you are with us. Thank you for this reminder that, Father, you can never leave us nor forsake us. Your praises to God is with us. That's why we worship you, Father, we give you praise. Drain and Lord. As you say to the disciples, peace be with you. You alone is peace, the giver of peace. I want to pray for everyone, oh God, who is doubting. Everyone who has lost peace because of the situation we are in. I pray for them, God. I lift them to you, pray that Jesus, at your word. At your word. More grace upon their lives and more assurance and reveal your word more to them so they will know that truly we save a God who is our refuge. Our God who is ever present, even in trouble, is ever there. We worship you, Father, and we give you praise because we know you are with us, God. And you continue to prove your faithfulness. We surrender all to you, God, bring them in this situation. May you be God, our God who is living, our God who is faithful, a God who can never be stopped by anything that we may be facing. We know, Father, the situation, oh God, is not as we expect, but one thing we know, we serve a God who is living. And is still in control. Our sovereign God is still in front. Bless everyone, O God, who took time, O God, to be part of this service. And may this word, O God, be able to bring peace and assurance in their lives and families. That you have not left them, you are with them, you are with us. And my praise, O God, may every home, O God, experience the peace from above. The peace that transcends all human understanding. The peace that guides our minds and our hearts, oh God. May that peace reign in every family, reign in every household, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. All of your praises, oh God, in every family. We worship you, Lord, and we give you glory. Because we know that Jesus, you blessed us with your peace. And you continue to prove your faithfulness. We worship you and we give you glory. In Christ's name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.